All right, we ready? Okay. So first off, thanks for sticking around. There's a fresh bowl of rotting vegetation under all the chairs now and for what you're about to see. But anyway, Lance was right, and what I'm going to present is something a little, actually vastly different than what you've been seeing for the past couple of days. Those are my two email addresses. And there's a lot that I've really wanted to say before this talk, but I kind of lost it. But either way, I just wanted to say that this is going to be a different thing that you're seeing. We're not going to talk about any particular kinds of engines. I have very, very few equations, as some of you that are familiar with this know. There's some other things that we'll talk about. This is kind of the discussion topics, and the first one's kind of most important, this caveats and ground rules, okay? Kind of setting the tone for the talk and what to expect from me. And then ask accordingly. So, we'll run through all these things and then hopefully have some great discussion at the end. So essentially the caveats and ground rules for this talk are, this one right here is a big one. I'm not a physicist, I'm not an astrophysicist or cosmologist. I know very little about quantum mechanics. I'm just an engineer, okay? So I don't have the formal training that maybe some of you do, but I have been in the engineering field for a while looking at space and so forth, and I've known this community for quite a while. This is a very conceptual, notional model of what I'm going to propose as a model for the universe and a variety of other things, okay, that all seems to hold fairly consistent with scientific observations and discoveries that everybody else is making, including yourselves. And they all seem to bundle nicely into this model. The support of all this comes from logical scientific extensions of well-known physics, cosmological observations, and so forth, present understanding of quantum mechanics. And if I miss the boat on a couple things, let me know, but I'll try to fit it in or stuff it into the ideas as best I can. But what I'm going to try to show you are some visual and graphical analogs for some very complicated things that we've always been dealing with. Like, what is space-time? What is charge? What is really going on when someone says space-time compression? Or what a charge field is. What really is that from a physical sense? Okay, and so I'm gonna try to put some colors and neat PowerPoint stuff to that without the use of math or equations. Like I said, this is a very graphical, very visual, conceptual thing based solely on conjecture, implication, inference, and supposition, all right? Like I said, I have no real formal training. I'm not very well versed in the math, and so this is all just, if this occurs or this was discovered, then this might be true or this could be implied. Okay, that's the kind of logic that this is going to take. You're not going to see transformations, tensors, reference frames, Lagrangians, or space warps. Sorry. Okay. Especially you, Lance, because you brought up the Lagrangians as being the, one of the determiners for a theory. So this may not be a theory. It's just a model. The ideas are, they're not set upon invalidating, challenging, or refuting anything that anybody else in this room has done or will do. This is just a different way of offering a different perspective of looking at the answers of what's, quantum mechanics and general relativity and so forth. Okay, so what does it mean? Is another way of looking at it. And as always, these are a work in progress, these ideas. So much of a work in progress that after decades of trying to figure out how to incorporate one particular concept, it came to me last night at 4:30 in the morning. And I literally wrote it down on a napkin in the bathroom at 4:30 in the morning. So thanks to the inspiration of this group and the mountain air and the mule deer or whoever, but it finally came to me, and now I can make this even more complete of a conceptual, notional, hypothetical model. Okay, so, so the genesis of all this came back in 1989 when I was an undergraduate at Embry-Riddle, and I just happened to stumble in the library across this book, or this note, report. Faster Than Light Particles, A Review of Tachyon Characteristics, okay? It's not a very long paper. I can send it to anybody. I've scanned it. It's in PDF, and it's all the courier type font, and that type. It's very ancient, but it had some remarkably simple aspects to it that I really latched onto, and it became the genesis for the whole tri-space concept that I'm going to show you. And from these few pages, it was, well, if that's the case, then this is what I read about in Discover last week, and this is what they showed in Scientific American, so this might be true, and this, so that's kind of how this all progresses. So after reading, this is about 27 years in the making of all of this, even up until last night, like I said. Unfortunately, no math, no experience, no experiments, right? It's just, that's not what I was geared to do. Okay, so let's get started right with the technical aspects of this model. Combining two very simple equations of special relativity, your mass increase as speed goes up equals mc squared. You get this, you normalize with respect to velocity, and you end up with this plot right here. Okay, this is all just basic algebra, right? So what you end up here is on this vertical axis is energy over mass, and on this axis, the horizontal axis, is a velocity over speed of light. So it's a ratio, where at one, you end up with being at the speed of light. So you end up with this hyperbolic and parabolic set of curves. On the upper right quadrant is really kind of what represents our current understanding of physics and nature, because we really don't know quite what negative quantities are. Martin presented a great talk about what negative mass could be, right? And there's other quantities like negative energy, but there's also, the whole thing about, well, we've never seen it, so how do we know we can make it, and what is it? So what I've proposed is we're just going to look at this quadrant up here, and this is what I'm calling the tri-space universe. So we're going to take a blown-up look at that. And basically it says that for a given, this is the energy over mass axis, the velocity axis, and here's the asymptote of the speed of light equals to one, okay? Basically what this says is that at any given energy state, there can be three possible velocities existing at any point in space: subluminal, luminal, or superluminal, okay? So at any given point in space. Now, what can be inferred from that is, well, the laws of physics are relatively different in those realms. So what that means, maybe, is that there could be three realms of existence all within the same space. And if you want to think of it as a multidimensional space or a hyperspace or an alternate space or whatever, that's your choice. But three, okay? So the first one I'm going to talk about is luminal spacetime, is what this essentially is. And on this luminal spacetime is everything that travels at the speed of light. Electromagnetic waves, photons, and a variety of other things, all in vacuum. Real energy, rest mass is equal to zero, all three spaces exist concurrent with this line. Velocity is always equal to the speed of light, okay? And luxons are the name of the particle, lux, light, and that kind of thing. Okay, so the second space is the one we exist in, subluminal space, where everything is in our observable world called tardions, all right? And so you increase energy, you get the higher velocity, and this is relativity right here, where no matter how much energy you put into something, you can only go one increment of velocity faster, then you have to put 10 times as much energy to get the same increment, and then 100 times, it's asymptotic. And this is where you can never accelerate a mass to the speed of light. And that's 100% true. We know that, right? Even the Large Hadron Collider can get 99.9, a bunch of nines, but never the speed of light on subatomic particles. So it's not like you can, get to 99% the speed of light, turn on the big thruster, and then jump right over. It doesn't work that way, okay? So, increase energy, you get higher velocity, there's real rest mass, right? We can bring something to rest and have and still measure its mass. Velocity's always less than the speed of light, all right? The third realm is called superluminal space. Now this one can be either interpreted as a fifth dimension or a hyperspace, and there's some other names for it we'll talk about a little bit later. Dark matter and dark energy may exist here. The particles that exist to the right of this asymptote are called tachyons, which is the title of that one paper, but there's tachyon electrons, there's tachyon protons, there might be tachyon hydrogen, there might be, there's tachyon is just a family of particles. But what's interesting here is it's a double asymptote type of realm where no matter how much energy you take or you put in, you can never slow down to the speed of light. Interesting. Which means that you have an imaginary rest mass because you can never stop the thing. You can never slow it down to something at an asymptotic level here. And on a similar way, you can never take out enough energy the more energy you take out, the faster you go to an infinite velocity. Now, I think what you said there was 10 to the 21 C, right? Or some, that was your talk, right? Whose talk said about 10 to, oh, that was yours, yeah, I'm sorry. Yeah, 10 to the 21 C. Richard Obusi had said something about 10 to the 35 C. So now we're starting to talk way, way out on this asymptote, but these velocities are, calculated, they're mathematically derived. But in this case, everything over here exists faster than the speed of light. It has to. It's natural for it to do that. What's interesting also is that as you approach the asymptote of the speed of light from both sides, relativity comes into effect in the same way. You started getting time dilation, you start getting length contraction, mass increase or decrease. Things work backwards over here. You push on the brake and you go slower. Refrigerators heat things up. It's really weird, okay? How you wrap your head around that is still a mystery, all right? Especially since everything has to be moving faster than the speed of light with respect to itself if it exists over there. Crazy, right? Nonetheless, this is what makes up the tri-space model: subluminal space, luminal space, superluminal space. And this is what is incorporated in the universe, all right? So what does this mean? Well, if I try to take what I drew with that chart and I put it into a two-dimensional realm, its trispace consists of two spaces bounded by one space-time, which is the luminal plane. It's a 2D representation of the universe. And so what I have is this, or try to interpret as this, okay? So we have the luminal space plane. We're going to just open it up this way, all right? We're going to look at the top and the bottom. Subluminal space is very familiar. You've seen this kind of a Minkowski metric before, where you have some sort of mass inside of a gridded sheet, and everything kind of goes in towards it, right? You make this dent in the luminal space-time plane, which is kind of the surface of everything. That represents gravity. That's a depiction of gravity, right, where everything falls into it. In the subluminal sense, though, superluminal sense, if you look underneath that Minkowski framework, what you see is kind of a bulge in that fabric, but you don't see any associated mass with it.
Is it okay to make comments?
Yeah.
Okay, I just want to point out with this rubber sheet model, there's a strange, you have to think that the flat space time, there's still gravity there, even though the people can look at the warping and say, oh, there's curvatures around there, so where the gravity is. But gravity is everywhere.
Oh, no, this is a very local phenomenon. Gravity, this is the whole outside of this is being deformed by everything else.
I'm just saying that rubber sheet model tends to give people the wrong impression. Even when it's flat, the gravity, the potential can be a constant.
Oh, sure.
Yeah, zero, hence the flatness.
Right.
Just because you have flatness doesn't mean you don't have gravity. Gravity's everywhere.
That's exactly right. So
this
is a
local... It's confusing people, so yeah. I just want to point that out.
Thank you. No, it's, you know, it's kind of like the whole flat Earth thing, right?
Yeah, so, exactly.
All right, so now this is very local to this particular mass. But what I wanted to say is, if you look on the superluminal space side, you see some sort of gravitational signature that looks repulsive, but you don't see any associated mass creating it. Now, we're going to talk about that a little later. As far as, you know, the existence of dark energy, dark matter, and exotic fields in superluminal space. But essentially, this is sort of the 2D representation of it, is that these three realms coexist at every point, okay? Luminal space-time, this boundary between these two can be referred to as the zero-point field, the quantum foam, the quantum vacuum. Basically, that is the space-time realm that we're all talking about when we say, or at least that I'm seeing that we talk about when we talk about space-time compression, quantum foam, and any of those vacuum-related terms.
Greg, don't we have quantum foam in subluminal space, or any physicist?
Yeah, it's.
Why do you identify it with just things moving at the speed of light?
No, they don't. Well, okay, go ahead, I'm sorry.
Like I say that. Yeah. I believe that when people talk quantum foam, it's here everywhere, even in subluminal space. And then also, why is quantum coming in for things moving at the speed of light? Why do you.
Well, quantum is just. That's just a term. Those are just terms that would have been used. I'm just saying that those constructs of what people think of as quantum foam and quantum vacuum and all that, I'm calling luminal space-time, where everything, well, we'll talk about that, about what that is, okay, and how mass gets involved, even with subluminal matter.
But just okay. You talk about the different space-times, but those are things moving, so
no,
you can have
no, they're not.
Something at rest
yes.
in this spot, something going the speed of light in this spot.
No. Well,
it's one more comment. Yeah, in your subluminal, time moves forward. In your luminal, time has no meaning. It's kind of stands still.
No,
superluminal,
no.
It goes backwards.
No.
Conventionally,
no. Conventionally, they do. That's right.
Sorry.
Yeah, let me get to the model. You're asking great questions about the mass and the time, and the time is actually the big one that occurred to me the other just recently. But yeah, we'll talk about this. Okay. All right, but first we need to talk about what is space-time, okay? What is this whole thing that we're trying to manipulate with EM fields and gravity and all this stuff? Okay, so to set the tone for this, there was a gentleman by the name of Richard Gauthier back in 2007 that he's a physicist at Santa Rosa Community College in California. And what he set out to do was he tried to come up with a model of the electron that to try to describe what was called the Zitterbewegung, which was the jittery motion that Dirac had noticed when he was trying to characterize the electron. And that was the one quality, a quality, that he couldn't figure out how to describe. You know, he got the rest mass charge and all the other stuff, but he couldn't figure out why it started shaking, okay? But so Richard decided to go and try to produce a model of the electron to account for this.
What's the shaking?
It's some sort of jittery motion of the electron.
Not the fluctuations, basically, a bit like gravity motion on the scale.
Okay, yeah, so anyway, what he tried to do was he set out to try to produce a model of the electron that did this. And so what he came up with was that if there was some sort of subparticle that created an electron, all right, and this subparticle was able to trace out a double helix closed path, where it has a small helical circle and then it goes around, comes back again, goes around, comes back again. And if there was a specific velocity distribution during that path, then he was able to reproduce that jittery motion, along with all the other characteristics of the electron. Now, what's interesting is this small entity that he calls a transluminal energy quanta, because what the velocity distribution of this entity is that, let me just hit the little buttons here. So this is what the double path helix looks like. The electron, that whole path thing is moving in orbit as the electron. This is what's called the TEQ, and it's going, you know, basically 24% of its time it spends in subluminal velocity, and then the other 76% of its time it's superluminal. And it smoothly transitions between those two velocities as it goes around this path. And when
the electron as a particle?
I'm sorry?
Are you treating the electron as a particle?
Yes. Yeah, I think that's how it is, all right? This is his model.
As opposed to a wave.
Yes, that's right, as opposed to a wave, because that's what Dirac was seeing, it was this thing. So when he...
Greg, from where's this ratio coming from? 76%, yeah.
This was derived in his paper as to say that...
Goldfish, 2000.
But what's the main assumption here? That it's one-third it's in real time and two-thirds it's in hyper...
That I don't recall off the top of my head, but I know it's in the paper because he comes up with that and said, this is what the ratios need to be, right? So nonetheless, what this might imply then is that if there is a smaller particle that even makes up the electron, which is a fundamental particle, then perhaps what this transluminal energy quantum could be is a fundamental constituent of space-time and make up all particles. Because Richard was able to reproduce the charge, the spin, the jittery motion, everything, the mass, everything with this particular arrangement and model. What we've been trying to get him to do is to carry this on and do some quarks and then see how those bundle together to produce a proton, something heavier. He's also gone through and looked at this model for what is a photon, what is a wave, okay, and how this thing might work, and you'll get a chance to see some of that later. But nonetheless, it's this transluminal energy quantum that freely transitions between these three velocities, without any kind of relativity breaking or anything of that nature. And somebody had mentioned in an earlier talk about the time dilation of an electron. And here it is. This is one model for it, because you have something that's moving at highly relativistic speeds, at least on the subluminal side and the superluminal side. They're pretty close to that asymptote where you would start to feel time dilation. So does the time dilation from superluminal cancel the one from subluminal? Don't know. I'm just saying that that's a possible application of that. But if this TEQ can be assumed to be a fundamental particle of space-time, then perhaps all particles, all fields, and everything can be manufactured with this TEQ phenomenon. And that's sort of where things start to go into a little bit more detail. So the geometry and the length of these things is yet unknown. It could be at the Planck scale, like a string, you know, which is kind of sort of what based this is sort of what's based on. But TEQs are everywhere, even in the absence of mass, because this is a fundamental constituent of space-time. So if there's space-time between galaxies, the space-time between an electron and a proton, TEQs are there. All right, they're everywhere.
What are the parameters that characterize a TEQ? You said the TEQ shows you the mass and the charge.
Yeah.
Maybe the spin or something. But
yeah.
What are the parameters of a TEQ that produce these other parameters?
Which other parameters?
Frequency, amplitude, and whatever, I guess.
Yeah. So charge, as you'll see, will come out whenever we look at what charge is in trispace based on the TEQ, of how the electron gets its charge. Magnetism, same thing.
But I say, does the TEQ not have any free parameters?
The parameterized equations for the TEQ in XYZ coordinates are in the paper and presentation in 2007.
I just sent it to you by email.
He's also presented things recently on this, too. I mean, like, as recently as earlier this year.
I'm just asking you guys, what are the parameters of a TEQ?
I don't know that off the top of my head. If you're talking about the quanta itself, that's circulating within the electron, defining the electron, because this fits all the experimental data they have on the electron.
I just wonder, how many parameters does it take to fit all the experimental data of the electron?
That I can't.
Just a simple.
There's probably six.
Six.
Thanks, David. Yeah, I'll be relying on you for a lot of this because you've done a lot of
Disclaimer, I have worked with Richard on this for over 10 years, making suggestions on this particular model. It's fascinating. Just a minor thing, because you're going to take over the charge thing. This particular model on the electron does not have charge in it yet, okay? That's what he's working on. He has another paper called The Charged Photon.
Oh yeah, right.
And it's a curved model, mm-hmm. but this model and another model by Williamson and Vandermarten are the leading models for the internals of the electron based upon experimental data, and they have a lot of references for that.
Yeah.
So is it safe to say that this TEQ that he has developed and your tri-space model, that this particle or quantum, whatever you want to call it, regularly goes back and forth across that boundary?
That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct. Now, if that's the case, one second. If that's the case, TEQs complete, you know, they have velocity, they have direction, they can transfer between back and forth between spaces. Now, if this model of the electron can be verified as true, and the TEQ can be, you know, considered a fundamental constituent of space-time, then all particles have this capability, have the TEQ capability where it goes back and forth. It may be a different path, it may be different velocity ratios, but the fact is that all mass may actually have a superluminal component to it. Now, we already know from wave equations that the group velocity of subluminal mass is subluminal, but the phase velocity is superluminal, just like this, right? We also know, well, I think I'll just stop right there. But either way, that's a really interesting thought, right? Is that that this particular model of the electron could possibly be expanded to cover everything, right? That we all have this inherent capability, that everything has an inherent capability to all of a sudden switch into superluminal space where the ratios reverse or this thing flips. Don't know, right? But it's interesting to think about that, right? You had a question back there.
The Zitter thing, which is a billion times a second, is that the complete cycle going from subluminal to superluminal, or is it?
I think Dave might have an answer.
The switch there.
Yeah.
It's a 720 degrees based on spin 1/2. It's a 720 degree cycle. Yeah. Okay, so it's. It's not just once, but it's two loops before repeat.
Okay, great. One more question, then I'm going to move on.
There's another way to get to the same place almost, and that is the quantum wave functions for the tax are sublight.
Yeah.
And that automatically provides a communication path from tax space to sublight space.
Mm-hmm.
And that could explain quantum entanglement. It could explain an awful lot of things.
Yeah, we'll talk more about that later, and from a more graphical perspective. But yeah, exactly right. So what this means, though, is if TEQs are everywhere, even in the absence of mass and fields, you know, because they are basically space-time, and you imagine that we live in this continuum of these things, then perhaps they have some sort of, you know, some sort of set of laws that they obey, and it doesn't really matter if it's mass or fields or whatever. But it's a fluidic process. It's a fluidic medium. Okay. Now I'm going to say the A word a little later, right? Well, AE, depending on how you spell it, right? But basically, charge, magnetism, EM waves, and other exotic fields can be modeled in space-time based on the orientation and path of these TEQs. We'll talk about that later, because what this brings up is something that I haven't really ever seen. But again, I'm not as well versed in some of these areas as you are. As is a graphical representation of what charge really is. What is going on in space-time that gives charge? What is going on that gives magnetism? Simple stuff like that, right? What is going on in photon? You know, we know there's charge and magnetism that are doing this, but what is that, right? And we'll talk about that a little bit later. So, characteristics of luminal space-time. Yes?
Before you go on, as part of looking at models for matter-antimatter engines, I had done some research looking at the slack data for Barbar, which is the Meson research. And the ratios in this
Oh, yeah, I remember this, yeah.
Go ahead. I gave a presentation a few years ago, and Robert Zubrin and I heard your asymmetry about this and realized that it was propulsion, if we could exploit that.
Yeah.
The ratios we looked at, some of the ratios in here compare favorably with the slack data on B meson decay. Now that has not been explored further. There's an asymmetry on the decay ratios that matched this at one point. Now I haven't looked at it recently, but that should be a follow through on.
Okay, but that's a great example of substantiation of this kind of an idea from experimentally observed data. Right, which I fortunately didn't have to go out and do. So, but no, thanks a lot, Dave. I appreciate your comments to help support all this stuff. Okay, so characteristics of luminal space-time, what is it, right? And so it's everywhere, it exhibits the same qualities between galaxies as does it between atoms. It's a divisional realm where all three spaces exist at the same time, in addition to the luminal plane, only one of which we can observe, and we'll talk about that as why. It has a thickness, okay? Because if there is some sort of fluidic medium that we're all existing in, then maybe we can apply a whole lot of other fluidic phenomena to space-time in general, like a surface, okay? Which a surface may have a thickness. It may actually filter some of the quantum energy states between spaces, like the Gautier electron. The surface adjacent to the subluminal space is more defined than that adjacent to the superluminal space. Now, very archaically, it just so happens you can compare trispace to something like what happens in an upside down bottle, a glass of beer, right? Well, and the reason I pick beer is it has a nice foamy head, okay? Up here is superluminal space, it's really dense, there's a lot of mass. Down here is subluminal space. Down here is superluminal space where it's kind of wide open to the atmosphere. It's much larger, it has much different states of existence to it. And somewhere in between here you have this head of beer or fluidic space-time, luminal space, where you kind of have this mix, all right? And so what goes on at the surface here doesn't really get transmitted down here, and what goes on here doesn't get really transmitted up there. But you can see, if you're here, you can see the surface of this, and if you're here, you can see the surface of that, okay? So that's essentially what we're talking about here. What also is interesting about superluminal space is that there's a much larger energy level that things can achieve in superluminal space because you're below that E over M naught C squared ratio of 1, which is where pretty much everything we do is right now, okay? But we'll talk about that a little bit more later. Okay, now, how does mass and time and space-time all mix together, okay? And this is something that I do not have a diagram for yet because of how this all came to me just recently. But in reality, all masses, all fields and everything, we all exist within this kind of a space-time realm, this luminal space-time, where at any given time we can have one of three velocities, right? So how does time and how does mass come into this where we can represent this in a graphical conceptual model, big quotes and underline there, okay? So what I'm gonna show is something this is the first time I've drawn this, so bear with me. Okay, so here is this luminal plane that I'm talking about. Up here is subluminal space. Down here is superluminal space, sub and super. Okay, I'm defining that there's going to be some sort of a thickness here. And what I'm proposing in this case is that to model what is going on, just to model, not in actuality, but to model, I'm gonna pick a subluminal mass, we'll call it Earth, we'll call it you or me, the water bottle. We're actually above this plane in time. Okay, weird, right? But what happens though is that we have this gravitational effect, And so essentially what happens is this last statement here. Mass affects space through time. Now, if I take this mass and I move it and I give it some delta velocity, what ends up happening is that the mass, or the mass kind of goes down a little bit. This time, this perceived time gets shorter. As you move faster and faster, you start approaching this luminal plane to the point where you're just above it at 99% the speed of light. And your time vector here, whatever you want to call it, your perceived time, perceived meaning looked at from the outside, has shrunk. And there's time dilation. Okay? In addition to what's going on here, and I'm not going to draw the gravitational well for this one, but in addition to the perceived time going down, and there's some sort of a reference line here, your gravitational signature has gotten very deep. There's mass increase. Okay? So this is a very graphical, first time I've ever drawn it, completely probably wrong interpretation of subluminal mass in space mixed with time. Yeah?
There are problems, but as an electron, let's say you have an electron or some particle in CERN and you accelerate the thing, its radiation field starts off at small speeds, being kind of lobes around the particle, like almost like a donut shape.
Like a shock wave?
Yeah, so the particle's moving in space, kind of around a lobe radiation there, lobe radiation down, like this. And as it gets faster and faster and faster, those lobes tilt forward, so it gets relativistic.
Yes.
At relativistic speeds, you can't really tell the difference between a charge to the electron and a pulse of light. It literally looks like a pulse of light.
That's right. That's
so it's a charge pulse of light. But that's basically what he's saying there. With your Fermi stuff, I'd say the Fermi is everywhere.
No, that's the thing. This is a model, right?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is the graphical representation. But as I mentioned in verbally is that everything exists within space-time. It's really kind of difficult to wrap your mind around three spaces existing all around you at the same time. But this is one way of graphically representing this. I'm not saying that this is a distance or a velocity. This is just a perceived time vector, right? Meaning the magnitude, the size of the vector is what your perceived time is. Small, large, right? This is a shorter time than this time. All right, very conceptual at this point.
Looks like falling into a black hole.
We'll talk about that later, black holes, okay? We're also gonna talk about relativistic stuff with small masses and small particles and how trispace and this luminal plane reacts with that. And it might support exactly what you said.
Okay. Electrons have been compared to black holes, by the way.
What's that?
Electrons have been compared to black holes.
Yes.
Okay, cool. All right, so I'm going to leave you with that. Now, I'm going to talk about the fluidic space-time, okay? Because we mentioned fluid before. Some people go, oh, geez, not again. And some people go, oh, that's interesting. Well, what is interesting is that it's starting to come back a little bit, all right? But let me give you a brief history on fluidic space-time. Pre-modern stuff explored a transmission medium of light. The Greeks did that. They call it the ether, right? That's the A word I alluded to earlier, luminiferous ether, because it supposedly had fluid-like properties, just like air does for the transmission of sound. A bunch of people unsuccessfully tried to characterize the ether. Pretty obvious that they weren't going to do it because of how space-time is with frame dragging and all that we know about now. Michelson-Morley basically said, no, there's no such thing. And it's kind of like, well, of course they weren't going to see the same thing or see anything. But by the earliest 20th century, relativity and quantum mechanics started to take hold. And people said, well, wait, we can do all this stuff without the ether. Let's get rid of the ether. All right, as far as EM and light, we don't need the ether anymore because we can do that with QM and and relativity. So, obviously they took hold, right? But there are still some things, I'll get to you in a second, Jose. There are still some things that the quantum mechanics can't explain. And that's what the ether can help with, all right? So there actually is quite a few papers and there's actually been quite a bit of research looking at, all right, let's go back to the whole ether concept and just kind of say, well, was it really that crazy? Is there really something there that can help us explain maybe perhaps this 120 orders of magnitude difference, okay, that you mentioned before, Dennis? So, space-time may exhibit fluidic properties, again, all right? Now, I'll get to your question in just one sec. Let me finish this, okay? So the treatment of space-time is sort of, as a natural process, is sort of returning in some way. Returning meaning that there's probably more papers that have been published in the past 5 to 10 years than there had been in the past 30, okay? Here's a bunch, selfless plugs for three of mine, okay, but here's one from Hal Puthoff, here's an article in Modern Physics, here's from one from David Froning, where he actually took some of the Maxwell equations and simulated what warp drive would look like, assuming that there's this ether and you're sending something at the speed of light through it. What would the shock waves look like? Because Dave is an aero guy. So, you know, there's actually been, you know, probably at least a dozen others that I'm familiar with to support this, right? Looking at white holes and so forth, look in turbulence models. And so there's all sorts of really interesting fluidic analogs that can be brought into looking at, to compare to quantum mechanics and cosmological observations. Very interesting.
Great, though. One thing to note, though, all these references are not really mainstream. And
you know, PhysRev D, or is it that one's not?
I haven't heard of that.
Okay.
So I was saying, yes, around, let me know if anything is not right.
Okay.
So this is just to the point that I don't know if an ether is mainstream or there's a renaissance of ether, you know, at Princeton or something.
Right. No, I got this list from a presentation I made years and years ago. I have some articles and some papers that I don't know, I forget where they were published as well, but I can put those in there as well. But nonetheless, even if it's not mainstream quite yet, people are still thinking about it again, right?
Well, you see, it's mainstream, which means right.
That's right. and just because it's not doesn't mean it's wrong, right? So, okay, Jose, you had a question.
Yeah, you're talking about the fluidic space-time and properties of a fluid.
Yes.
What are the properties of a fluid?
We'll talk about that in a second.
To you, but you're using the term fluid.
Yeah, we'll get right to that question.
Okay, then we follow with this. You're using the word ether, but ether will consider to be a solid. So are you making no difference between a solid and a fluid, or are you making a difference between a fluid and a solid?
I've never heard of it being considered a solid.
Well, it's because the speed of light was supposed to be the square root of E, which is the modulus of elasticity of this ether, had a very high modulus of elasticity divided by its density. That's a solid. Mm-hmm. The difference between a solid and a fluid is that a solid is defined by a quantitative equation that relates stress to strain, mm-hmm. to deformation, mm-hmm. while a fluid has a quantitative equation that relates the shear stress, not to the shear strain, but mm-hmm. to the shear strain rate. Another difference is that a fluid usually is incompressible, while a solid is compressible.
So, for example, the way around.
True.
A solid is compressible.
Yeah, right. That's you said
a fluid,
that.
A fluid is incompressible.
Okay, maybe I just heard it. Okay, but no. All right. Well, the answer to your question is it's a fluid.
Why?
What's that?
Why do you think it's a fluid?
Because the TEQs make up a fluidic realm. That's, I mean, they behave together as a fluid, they move together locally as a fluid.
And what no properties of a fluid does it have?
I'll show you.
Okay.
Okay,
you had in the other slide, you said that there are phenomena that we cannot model with quantum mechanics and that could support an ether approach. What kind of phenomena are there?
That's a good question. I have been told that. but you know, I'm quantum mechanics doesn't answer everything, and I don't recall.
That's the question. I don't know what they mean by it.
It answers most things.
It's one quantum optics person, and sometimes they say, "Oh, we don't understand this," but they're just trying to make a big hype.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
I mean, even quantum mechanics does offer explanations for that. This offers an explanation for the quantum mechanics side of things. So it all can still hold together very well. Okay, so as I mentioned before, you know, there's a lot of theories that don't really, you know, that have accurate mathematical representations of charge, magnetic fields, and gravity, but none really have a physical analog. And that's one of the things I'm going to try to attempt to show you here. So what this whole tri-space business is a topology-based graphical approach to these things, especially when you're considering space-time as a quasi-fluidic medium. So here we go, Jose. Tri-space proposes that the luminal plane can be equated to a fluid medium and has properties analogous to those of a fluid. All masses and fields are fluidic phenomena, therefore. Okay, everything is some sort of entity floating in a fluid. Okay, and it has both sub and superluminal components, because if the TEQ can go back and forth between these two spaces, then it has these two components. So I already mentioned that space-time may have a surface that supports all electromagnetic energies and particles, because at the surface is where the luminal realm exists, right? So only things that can move at the speed of light are down on that surface. And this is, of course, vacuum speed of light, right? So, photons, electromagnetic radiation, that sort of thing. Along with that, there may be a surface tension like quality, okay? And we're gonna see how that comes into play when we start looking at small masses and quantum gravity, okay? To where you don't really distort the whole thing. If there's a thickness to that surface, you only kind of ride on top of it, kind of like a water bug does on a pond. All right, where it doesn't displace the water, it just kind of uses the surface tension effect. Anyway, we'll talk about that in a minute. Space-time exerts a pressure. That's a term that's very commonly used. The Casimir forces, zero-point fields, and so forth. A lot of people have been talking about space-time pressures. I think even the Q thruster mentions that. Space-time is easily distorted and displaced by the motion of mass. Now, we commonly hear distorted, right? The Minkowski metric, distortion of space-time is equal to, represents gravity and that kind of thing. But the new factor imposed here, which I'll talk about later, is the displacement of space-time in favor of mass, and what that does, and what that means to the surface, and what that means to what definition of gravity is, and what the definition of inertia are in this model.
So I still didn't see what are the,
there's more going. So space-time also has a density and a compressibility. We heard from Tony about a lot of the density fields. There's a compressibility effect to it, okay? It resists the change in volume. You can squeeze it, as you mentioned kind of some in some of your talk. The surface has a different density than the bulk, just kind of like the head on the beer has a different density than the sub and superluminal spaces on their own. It also has a viscosity and viscoelastic qualities.
A viscoelastic is a solid, it's not a liquid.
Okay. viscosity is a fluid.
Viscoelastic means solid.
Let me keep going with this. You're gonna see where this all ends up, okay? So it's a two-phase system right here that we're talking about, but we'll talk about that in a second.
Right, real quick, you say space-time, are you talking about the subluminal or the luminal?
The luminal. Yeah, just because everything exists there.
So this density and compressibility of space-time, you're not talking about the subluminal or the superluminal.
No, I'm talking about the luminal realm where everything already exists.
But we're in the subluminal realm.
We're experiencing subluminal speeds in luminal space-time because we're receiving light from the lights. Okay? So, that's what I mean. It's a really convoluted way to think about this.
So just in terms of the definitions you gave, I'm trying to understand it. You talked about the three different.
Yeah.
But those three things exist at the same time.
That's right.
In your model.
Right.
So we're really in all of them. Right?
We're in all of them, but we're experiencing the subluminal physical laws that are associated with that.
Because of our sensory systems and our physical body.
Or just the state of the TEQs of the electron having that particular velocity distribution.
Well, you're not ascribing density and compressibility to the normal world we live in.
No, to space-time itself. Well, I mean, I don't know what you mean by that, the normal.
Well, you talk about there's three spaces, three dimensions that overlap, right?
Mm-hmm.
Three. And now you're saying the word space-time. I just wondered, which of the three is it, or is it all three?
It's all of them. Like I said, everything exists in one continuum that has three possible velocities to it at the same time. So depending on your energy state within that continuum, you'll either experience subluminal, luminal, or luminal velocity. But you're in the same...
But you used to call that space in a few previous slides.
That's right. I'm calling it space, because when you're down at the luminal level, like Heidi said, as things kind of get close to that level and you get into the luminal realm at those speeds, time becomes meaningless. There is no such thing as time. Right? So time disappears at that luminal level.
So when you use the word space-time, you mean all three of what you previously called spaces before?
Yes.
Or three velocity states?
Yes. Okay. Yeah. And I was not clear in the time I had to work on this presentation to adequately make this clear, but I'm really glad for the feedback, because I know what's bringing, what kind of questions. Okay, so what I'm saying is that the viscosity part of this, and you'll see viscoelastic later on when we talk about gravity, are the causes of gravity and inertia. the causes of gravity inertia, okay? The resultants of gravity inertia, or the effects of that, are the distortion and displacement of space-time. But again, we'll talk more about gravity a little bit later. Okay, TEQ boundary layers can be modeled in space-time. Again, another fluidic property, okay? Frame dragging, lens thirring effects, those are all basic, very large boundary layer, similar type of boundary layer effects, where you have something rotating or moving, it's dragging the other rest of the space-time with it, and some distance away, it's not affected at all. Okay, that's a viscous type of, that's almost a viscosity type of environment, right? So that's why I got this here, right? So if you can have boundary layers like this, you can also, you may also have frame dragging, you may have vorticity, all existing within space-time, and we know that that's true already, but from a lot of different models. Yeah?
Almost all of your analogies you're using here pertain to continuum fluid mechanics.
Yes.
This is not continuum.
That, why isn't it not?
So because the mean free path and it is way too large.
Is like,
it's way too rarefied.
Well, that's for a massive, that's for a particle, right?
My point is, there are probably better analogies to this than what are being used here.
Okay.
These are way too conventional to continue flying.
Right. That was the idea, is to keep things as simple as possible, but still within the realm of the possible. Right? So when we start talking about some of the more, you know, what gravity and what inertia are, you'll see how this, you'll hopefully that'll answer some of the questions.
I think what Dennis means is that to say you have a continuum, it means that you have a certain density. Because I'm trying to define refractive index for two atoms, you really can't. You have to have a certain density to be able to define a macroscopic term like refractive index or something. I think that's because it's so rarefied, can you even apply that terminology?
Right.
Is it appropriate? That's just a question.
No. Was that the right question, Dennis? Did you hear that? Okay, she tried to reiterate your question to me. I don't know if you want to say it again.
I'll say it again, point my voice that way. I just mentioned that to apply the word continuum to the space, it kind of implies that you have a certain density. It's like trying to apply a refractive index to a system of two atoms. You really can't do that. You have to talk quantum mechanically and talk about the two individual atoms. You need a whole bunch of atoms, many of them, to have this macroscopic effect, which is a refractive index. It's like you do with a continuum. You need a macroscopic number of particles. Is that what you meant? Some of the terms are not applicable to space-time because it's so rarefied.
You can do that in algebra. Okay, my only point is, I mean, I'm a fool without answers, okay? This is one thing I do know a little bit about,
right.
As opposed to physics, which I don't know much about. In the fluid dynamics, the continuum fluid dynamics, which is all the stuff he's talking about, it's just almost completely different. As you go more and more rarefied, okay.
There's no such thing as rarefied
physics associated with it. Very different dynamics. Very different.
I understand. You have to go to the quantum realm when you have sort of separate atoms. You can't use a continuum limit.
But I think I understand. But there is no rarefication of this. TEQs are everywhere, always, everywhere. They're everywhere. There is no rarefication. There's no point in space where there's going to be less space-time than anywhere else.
This stuff requires, these models in fluid mechanics require a very small mean free path.
You
need a certain number of collisions to do
this.
Yes, exactly. That's what I was saying, is the TEQs are right next to each other. There's no mean free, you know, it's almost a zero.
But the dynamics of those collisions for these kind of particles and this kind of,
yes,
is just very different from the usual stuff.
That's right, but that's the model. Is that there? It's everywhere, you know.
It's at a common density, you're saying?
The densities change, just like what, you know. This is some figure I pulled off of the internet, right? But I don't know what that is. But there are different densities, right? There's a density within mass that is different than a density outside. You know, outside.
Space-time density, you're saying? Is
space-time density can change. Yeah, absolutely.
Something just clicked. When you have like pairs popping out of the vacuum,
yes.
It exists for a very, very short time, 10 minus 22 seconds.
Yes.
So of course, the mean free path is going to be really, really short. So
that's right.
Can you apply continuum physics if you think it can that kind of really short time frame? when you have these photos so close together. I'm not sure.
That's exactly right. That's exactly the kind of the continuum that I'm trying to convey here, is that this stuff is everywhere. I mean, we have to get away and go way, way deeper than the electron and electron level and particle mean free path. It's the constituent of everything. go ahead, Martin, and then I'll get back to you, Dennis.
And so you're saying the density of these TQs is everywhere the same, exactly the same?
No, not always.
No, it changes.
It changes. Like within mass.
But the average density is, you said it's everywhere, you're saying it's everywhere, so I assumed...
Well, think about this. There's how much of the observable universe is mass? What, 4% or something like that? Right? The rest of that 96% pretty much has the same density. Right, so what we know, any localized density change is going to, any density change is going to be very localized to some sort of mass or something associated with mass. All right, and so we have here, a realm where you can actually have I'll just stop right there. But does that help, or is that answer your question? Okay, all right. So anyway, Dennis had just left, so I'll just keep going. So vorticity exists. Again, this is continuum fluid dynamics, which is actually a great term.